the start of World War II, Germany attacked Poland on September 1st, 1939. Within days, Britain and France declared war on Germany. But World War II really kicked off when the British transatlantic passenger ship, the SS Athena, was sunk by the German submarine, or U-boat, 30, on September 3rd, 1939. Just 1 week later, Canada, as part of the British Commonwealth, joined the war on September 10th. The first Canadian convoy set sail from Halifax, Nova Scotia on September 16th with a destroyer escort of HMCS Saguenay and HMCS Saint Laurent. After the initial German-Russian battle over Poland, Germany then attacked Norway and Denmark in April 1940. By May of the same year, the Germans had overrun Holland, Belgium, and had turned back the French and British forces to Dunkirk, France, where 300,000 troops had to be evacuated to England. In what's referred to as the 5 days in May in 1940, the Prime Minister of Britain at that time, Sir Winston Churchill, had to convince his war cabinet to decline Germany's suggestion of a peaceful occupation by the Germans, and instead, Britain should stand and fight. As an island nation, Britain was heavily dependent upon the shipments of food, fuel, steel, and other peacetime and wartime materials from other countries. Now, if Halifax, Nova Scotia had not been willing and able to provide fuel, food, and water in addition to convoy protection for 1,500 merchant and warships in 44 convoys from September 39 to May 1940, Britain would not have received the crude oil and food to allow them to consider waging war. In the Atlantic side of Cape Breton, in August of 1940, coal-burning ships began joining in convoys. They would launch regularly from Sydney, Nova Scotia, supplied by the plentiful coal mines nearby. These convoys out of Sydney were a tad more visible to the German submarines, or U-boats, due to the thick, dark coal smoke emanating from the steamer's smokestacks, plus they were several knots slower than the Halifax oil-fueled convoys. Although Canada had joined World War II on September 10, 1939, our good friends and neighbors to the south, the United States, did not enter World War II formally until December the 11th, 1941. This only after they'd been attacked by Japan at Pearl Harbor. For the first 27 months, Britain, Canada, and the Commonwealth stood alone against the German threat in Europe. Thus, Canada played a very crucial role towards the eventual triumph.
Britain owes an incredible debt to Canadian armed forces, and I want to pay tribute to them today. In our darkest hour in World War II, Canadian naval forces helped to keep the sea lanes open during the Battle of the Atlantic, running convoys across the Atlantic week after week, braving mines, submarines, and blacked-out silent ships, all of which provided absolutely fundamental to our ability to survive as an independent country.
During those first 8 months of World War II, from September 1939 to May 1940, Canada sent a total of 44 convoys of supplies from Halifax and Sydney, Nova Scotia, to Britain. The Imperial Oil Refinery provided bunker sea fuel to all oil-burning ships in those convoys. Tankers were loaded with crude oil and other products, then sailed by convoy to Britain, where the oil was refined into other much-needed petroleum products. Raw materials, food supplies, and manufactured goods came from all over Canada in a constant flow on rough roads and by rail, destined for Britain. Ocean freighters brought supplies, food, and crude oil to Halifax from Central and South America. Supplies came from Asia, Australia, and New Zealand, with their ships coming through the Panama Canal and traveling up the coast of the United States to Halifax. At that time, many in the United States still supported Germany under the U.S. Neutrality Act of the 1930s, with some providing the Germans with both investments and much-needed supplies. It was not in Germany's best interest to bring the United States into the war, and thus, that particular supply route along the U.S. East Coast remained relatively safe for the first 2 years. Seafaring ships of all types would gather by the hundreds each month to Halifax and Sydney, Nova Scotia, where they were formed into convoys of between 20 and 100 ships. The Royal Navy and the Royal Canadian Navy warships provided these convoys much-needed protection for the voyage to Britain and to France, at least until the French were occupied by Germany in 1940. Once a convoy arrived at port, the ships were quickly unloaded. After unloading their cargo, the convoys headed straight back to Halifax or Sydney, Nova Scotia, loaded up with fresh food and water before heading back to their ports of origin, but not before a little R&R. After having spent weeks at sea, crew members were welcomed in local taverns, rooming houses, restaurants, and dance halls. A time to get away from the anxiety, stress, and boredom of ships at sea, especially during wartime. Just outside Halifax proper, the Bedford Basin became a beehive of activity. The Imperial Oil Refinery sent barges to refuel the oil-burning freighters anchored there. Smaller boats brought supplies of food and fresh water for every ship. Canadian and British warships came to the Bedford magazine to restock supplies of depth charges, ammunition, and torpedoes. Dealing with a constant threat of attack by German submarines, or U-boats as they were called, from 1939 to 1945 was a real learning experience, especially for the Royal Canadian Navy. These convoy battles in the Atlantic were fought largely by Canadian reservists in small ships, built in Canada and operating from Canadian bases. These Canadians were in a large part the defense of the North Atlantic. In 1939, the Royal Canadian Navy consisted of just 13 ships, of which only 6 were capable of transatlantic duty. At the war's end, the Canadian Navy had become the third largest navy in the world, with over 350 ocean-going ships. After the war ended in 1945, for decades as part of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO, the Royal Canadian Navy became one of the best anti-submarine warfare navies in the world.
So will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. Again, don't know when, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.